Welcome to the Bauer Power Hour, where we pack motorsports, power sports, and the outdoor lifestyle with technology, innovation, news, and good times into an action-packed dirt-flinging show. Hosted by the one and only Charlene Bauer, who's been serving the off-road industry for over 20 years. Time to throw the green flag and get ready for another wild lineup.
Welcome back to Bauer Power Hour. We have another huge lineup of guests today, including Lacrecia Beurrier from Rockstar Racing, Bob Sweeney from Jeepers Jamboree, and we'll bust some myths on the Oh Wow section. Bauer Media is composed of a lot of different properties, as we like to call them. Today, I wanted to give you a little insight into our I'm Not Just a Girl clothing, jewelry, and gift line. Well, let's start right there. It is primarily a clothing line. We have t-shirts, v-neck shirts, tank tops, long sleeve shirts, and sweatshirts that fit from extra small to 4XL. I believe that everyone is welcome in my world, and we design it as such. I create the designs right here at this desk with the concept that it is respectful enough that my mom will be willing to wear it, and that the teen will think it's cool enough to wear, and that all of us tough girls in the middle will like it as well. The materials that I use are very flattering to all shapes and are mostly on the longer side. I always test them. I wash and dry all my shirts regularly, and they are hardy and nice. Some of the designs that we have put together include guns, tire tread, off-road icons, semi-trucks, nuts, bolts, and tools. But we also have those pinks, the flowers, and the American design flags as well. A well-rounded option for just about every girl out there is my goal. I come up with a new design every other month, basically inspired by different tough girls, and try to make something for them. Or something randomly catches my eye and I stop and draw it out on a piece of paper. Essentially, you never know when that paper will show up on the computer screen as a final product, but literally, you guys, that's how it happens. We do have a jewelry line that has everything from cute $9.99 necklaces to silver Jeep, dirt bike, snowmobile, quad, and buggy charms that we can make necklaces or earrings out of. They're all super cute. Our gift line includes items like I'm Not Just a Girl backpacks and plastic tumbler cups and tote bags and more. Most of these gifts go to the girls in the club though, but some make it online for sale as well. All right, did club just perk your ears? I hope so. The I'm Not Just a Girl club members get the newest shirt hot off the press with a gift and generally more. If you have ever received a package from us here, you know there's always more in there than you ordered. So for $29 every other month, you'll receive that, and it includes the shipping as well. So the big question, right? How did I'm Not Just a Girl get started? Well, it's actually a really interesting story, so I'm going to tell you. Every business has its challenges, and Bauer Media is no different to that. I was faced with the challenge of the economy, but in a little bit different way than you may think. I was crisscrossing the country, going to events everywhere, but literally the increasing travel budget, aka diesel fuel, made it really unreasonable for me to stay on the road. Gas money, folks. I needed gas money. Plus, I wanted my own brand to wear, something other than Bauer Media brand. I realized this in February of 2011 while I was at King of the Hammers. About 3 days later, I jumped onto a plane to go to Indianapolis for the Power Sports Dealer Expo. And at my layover in Denver, I did what every girl would do and wandered into the jewelry store to see what they had on display. I got it. I'll make and sell jewelry. Well, that was pretty easy, right? As I left the Denver airport and headed to Indy, my laptop died about halfway through the flight, and me in a plane with nothing to do is like trying to contain a cat with catnip toy. So my brain did somersaults over the different opportunities, the failure points and the positive points of my ideas, and I got off the plane still feeling confident that I'd find a solution, and I was almost there. It was a really cold week in Indy, like it always is, but I was ready. And I was chatting with some of my friends that have a girl shirt line. I offered them the idea of selling their brand on my online store that would feature the jewelry. With little hesitation, they were awesome. They're like, yeah, for sure, we'll be your first brand. And as I walk away, I remembered saying to them, Don't be mad if I come up with my own line. It's just in my personality. I kind of figured it was going to happen. The question was, what was that line? Right? It was still kind of hanging out there in the wind. So as I continued my trip, I was wandering the show and I got towards the back corner where I saw a row of new products. Jumping in and out of the different booths, I'm like, oh, there's a snowplow display. Yes, snowplows. I'd just written an article, so I wanted to see why his were different. I know it's super random, but that's the truth. And not by any means disrespectful, the gentleman that I was talking to started the discussion at the lowest step of explanation of what a snowplow was. I could have started about 5 steps up. But how do you tell somebody that? How do you tell them that just because I'm a girl doesn't mean that I don't know what I'm looking at? And I specifically remember contemplating in my mind how I would try and explain my experience to him in like 1 or 2 sentences without being mean. Of course, he rambled on about what I already knew. Well, when I opened my mouth, it rolled off my tongue. I'm not just a girl, I have, and I stopped. I'm sure I had a smile on my face at the time, but I instantly dug into my jeans for a pen and paper to write it down before it escaped me. I said, thank you very much, and I walked out. And I guess at the end I was a little rude, and I really wish I knew who I was talking to so I could let him know the outcome of our conversation, because that's where I'm not just a girl actually came from. Anyways, the flight back to California was long, but I used it to contemplate every angle. I started to tell my story to my mentors and see their reactions of the option of a clothing versus jewelry and accessory line. I never did tell anybody the name, only about 20 people or so knew the actual brand name before I launched it. But I continued to define and redefine my concept, like any right business. Within 3 weeks, I had the first 5 designs ready. Yes, 3 weeks. I picked them up the night before I left for Moab Easter Jeep Safari. I stayed up for 3 nights wrapping, tagging, and sorting, while also maintaining my normal media job. I was literally exhausted. I stayed at Grandpa's garage, and on Tuesday night is one of the big parties of the week. So Danny allowed me the opportunity to set up my shelving, all my racking, and release it to the world. April 19th, 2011 is that day. We just celebrated its 4-year anniversary, and it's definitely an exciting time for sure. So please look it up online at imnotjustagirl.com, where we also have some of our more crazier stories posted. You can purchase a shirt direct from us through Etsy, through Open Sky, and very soon we're going to be on Amazon. Very excited about that. We also have them on multiple trucks that crisscross the country. You can find I'm Not Just a Girl at any Dirt Riot or We Rock event, 4-Wheel Parts Truck Fest, or at any Jeepers Den event that they're set up at. And of course, at the events that I have a booth at. So that is the I'm Not Just a Girl story, and I appreciate all of the people that have followed and been a part of that. Now, the second piece that I want to talk about, I've been asked a lot what my favorite event has been. And honestly, that's a really hard one for sure. There's definitely so many that I go to. So I'll talk about a few of them from time to time. I have to admit that the one that takes the cake for me, being different and exciting, is Pikes Peak. I've only had the opportunity to go there once in 2011, and it was the last year that there was dirt on the mountain. Originally, Pikes Peak was an all dirt road, and over the course of years has been paved a little bit at a time. After the 2011 race, it was to be completely paved, so it was definitely time to make that trip. In addition to the dirt element, JT Taylor had riled up a group of Ultra 4 drivers to run the hill with him, including Dave Cole, Sam Barry, Kevin Yoder, Roger Lovell, and Brad Lovell. Honestly, do I need to say more? That alone was quite the experience with all of us together. Just to set the stage, Pikes Peak is a week-long event starting with 3 practice sessions. Each of them have specific groups of drivers, starting at 5:30 in the morning and ending at 9:30. There are 3 days of practice. Saturday is a day off, and then Sunday is race day. During practice, which I thought was really interesting, the bottom section is timed and recorded, so your best time out of the bottom section is your qualifying time. The starting order for race day is slowest to fastest, with the fastest qualifier having the opportunity to go whenever he wants. Now, this is actually really important because as the weather changes throughout the day, the fastest qualifier can bump anybody at any time understanding the weather and go when he wants. Really a cool dynamic to that race. By the end of the lower section practice though, you know your starting order for the race. So does that make sense? Easy, right? Well, here's our story. I kind of went back and refreshed my memory with the videos and pictures that we put together. So Monday, our group compiled, and on Tuesday, it was off to Tech and the rookie meeting. Tech was organized and official, but honestly, I'll tell you, it wasn't as big as I might have thought it would be. The teams came, and then they went as quickly as the officials were satisfied and put their stickers on and all that type of stuff. Then we went inside and we had the rookie meeting, and it was really interesting. The thing that stuck out the most to me was when the race director said, "The mountain has a spirit of its own. Respect it." And I did, and I still do today. There's a couple incidents that we had. So Wednesday was my first day on the mountain. We were lucky enough to have our group start practice in the upper section. Now, the altitude is no joke. When we stepped out of the truck at 12,900 feet at 4:15 a.m., it was cold and dark. And I mean cold. I started to do a little dance to warm up, you know, and JT looked at me like I was crazy. Then he got to laugh at me a few minutes later as I went, woo, as I felt the altitude hit. Didn't take much walking to know that there certainly was not going to be any running. So seeing past the trees also was an issue. There were none. The tree line is 12,000 feet, for those of you who may not know. After practice, we went all the way to the top to be a tourist for a minute, and that is 14,110 feet. It's pretty crazy up there. Absolutely amazing. Then on Thursday, we were in the lower section, which included the dirt section to get the rock throwing action. With not getting through to the right people at the right time, that plan got a little adjusted to me hiking up the mountain. Don't worry, I didn't really hike it. It was more like walk, hear a car coming, stop, take a picture. Walk, hear a car coming, stop, take a picture. It really was quite doable. Some people actually hike the whole thing. That's not on my list of things to do though. So anyways, I got some good pictures from different spots with the peak in the background. It was actually really, really pretty. I also realized that I wanted to be in the dirt on race day. I mean, that is why we were there that day. It was the last year of the dirt. Friday then was the last day of getting up at 3:30 a.m. for practice. And Friday night was the Fan Fest in downtown Colorado Springs. There were over 30,000 people estimated in attendance, which I will definitely say is true. The crowds were packed around all the vehicles, and it was a blast watching the guides give the kids autographs and being able to check out all the vehicles around them. Saturday was an off day on the schedule. Seriously, in the beginning, I'll be honest with you, I wondered why. But the lack of sleep and elevation change all week really does add up. The 2:15 a.m. wake-up calls, the 3 a.m. leave times, the 5 a.m. driver meetings, the 5:30 on the course, holy cow, we definitely needed to sleep in. So after sleeping in, it was time to put the final touches on the cars, load them up, and head to the mountain to camp. Yes, this is the only night that they allow camping, is the night before the race. Pretty exciting, and we definitely could not pass that up. Pikes Peak does throw a lot of variables at the cars between the altitude gain, the tight turns, the asphalt, and the dirt combination. And this year in 2011, when we were there, the asphalt reached temperatures of like 110 in different places. Well, the dirt soaked it right up. And on the flip side, there's also challenges from the spectator perspective. You can only be in one place. You may be able to move a turn or two, but honestly, not much farther. With that being said, the Pikes Peak commentary broadcast is over an AM station. So no matter what rock you're sitting on, you could still hear exactly what was happening. It was really neat. It reminded me of what it must have been like when there was only radios. So as a driver went past us, we all turned our eyes to the radio for the rest of the run up the mountain. It was pretty neat. I've been lucky enough to go back to Pikes Peak on one other occasion with a group of dirt riot racers. It was fun going to the top to experience the altitude again. If you ever have a chance to go to Pikes Peak, do it. If you ever have a chance to be part of the race week, definitely do it, just like you heard Jason Voss say earlier. It is definitely something that you want to put on your bucket list. So for more information on the event, you can always go to ppihc.com or search Pikes Peak on our Bauer Media website to see all of our videos from the week. Well, that's enough about me. Let's get back to the phone lines with a girl that has been around UTVs since their inception. Brought to you by I'm Not Just a Girl.
Hi, I'm Charlene, and after going to lots of events, I found something missing. Cute girl shirts that actually fit. I said, well, we can fix that. And now I design a new shirt every other month for the tough girl that wants to tell the world I'm not just a girl. We have designs with tire tread, guns, bling, American flags, camo, camping gear, and so much more. Available in extra small through 4XL, you can choose between high quality tanks, tees, or sweatshirts, and we have a whole line of jewelry and gifts as well. Visit imnotjustagirl.com to see all the designs and size charts. Available direct through Etsy, Open Sky, or at multiple events across the country. Be sure to send us photos of you being I'm Not Just a Girl to our Facebook page.
Let's welcome Lacrecia Beurrier from Rockstar Racing, a three-time Mint 400 champion, 2009 Powder Puff winner. Driving her Polaris Razor is a factory-sponsored driver. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. How are you guys?
Good, good. So let's roll right into it. Give us some of your racing background.
I've been racing since 2008. I've been racing side-by-sides the whole time. My husband's a fabricator, and he started building side-by-sides when they were hot. And I asked for a race car, and he built me one, and we've been racing ever since.
Nice. So what are some of your... We just brought up the Mint 400 wins. What are some of the other things that you've accomplished in your racing career?
First of all, I guess I could say we won the Powder Puff. It was a huge accomplishment for us the first year that we went. There were 10 awesome ladies there driving. I crashed a few times. They even rolled the car, and we still finished fourth. 10 drivers, and we were hooked. But we really, really, really wanted to win that race. So we came back next year with, that was our, had our heart in it, was actually chasing Corey Weller in her R1. And I could catch her in the rough stuff, but as soon as it got flat, obviously she ran away from me. And I remember calling on the radio saying, I can't catch her. My husband says, don't worry about it. As long as you have her in your sight, you just won.
Nice. Nice.
That was a huge accomplishment. And from there on up, you know, we went from racing girls to now I race with the boys. And we do extremely well. In fact, we're in the points lead right now for the UTV Unlimited Pro class in Best in the Desert.
So there's multiple classes in UTVs now, which I think is really an awesome change from the beginning of the UTV inception. Remember way back when we started racing, how has that changed the way that you guys are building your vehicles?
The cars are so much faster now than they used to be. I mean, our top speeds used to be, we'd be excited if you could go in the 50s, maybe 60 if you had a really fast car. And now we're exceeding 85 miles an hour in a similar sized vehicle. So my husband is my fabricator. He's really cautious about safety and make sure the car's still light but extremely safe. So we probably build them a little heavier maybe than they need to be, but they have to be safe going at that speed. If you roll at going to 85, you don't want anything to crunch.
Right. Don't disagree with that. Well, what was your worst crunch since we're here?
The worst one was at Silver State last year. I actually rolled the car twice. I don't know what happened. I don't know if I was having a bad day. I didn't feel like I was driving any worse than any other time. But we were going through some switchbacks, and I was hitting them just as hard as I hit them at the Mint, and I went over. And the first time, not too bad. We got some bystanders come by, pull us over, no big deal, got back in the car, took off. The second time, we were going faster. It was a little harder. I couldn't get out of my seatbelt. I couldn't get the car rolled over. There was fuel dripping. It was not a good thing. So that was probably my worst day ever.
Yeah, I'd say that was that sounds pretty rough. So walk us through getting ready for a typical race. Planning starts, how far in advance, what kind of time do you have invested in it? What does it take from the UTV perspective?
Probably similar to most of the other classes and cars, I guess. It depends on how much time we have between races. A lot of times we only have a month, so we like to try to give everybody a week off after a race, and then we tear the car all the way down, check everything out, put it back together, replace what we need to replace, and then normal prep things like changing fluids and CVs and that kind of thing. This summer, we've been off for a couple of months, but we still started early, getting some things repaired on the car, checking out some things. Now we had a bad wire harness, which is good because it was back ordered from Polaris, so we're lucky that we started early, so we weren't at the last minute trying to find a wire harness. So we're pretty close to putting the car back together and going out and doing some testing, and then we wait for the race. And I think most programs and other classes are similar. I know, you know, it takes a good couple of weeks to prep the car really well and hopefully don't find anything broken.
Right. So you're a Polaris factory racer. What does that mean? What does that mean?
You know, as a huge accomplishment, it was so exciting. Last year we raced a Can-Am, and we really had a terrible season, but we still performed well, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So we caught eyes of Polaris, which they have been looking at us for a while, I guess, because we've always performed really well. We have a good team. We just didn't race every race. Last year we raced every race, and they really liked that, so they called us up and asked us if we'd be interested in racing with them. So they gave us a car and a little bit of budget and sent us out racing. So it's a huge accomplishment. I mean, I'm extremely honored to be one of the factory drivers for sure.
Yeah, that's awesome. So going way back when, right? Like, when did we meet? I don't even remember. It was way back in the 08 days. You guys have a shop in Lake Havasu. And what do you do there? And what are the different types of vehicles that you work on?
He really works on anything. He built a pre-runner Bronco last year. It was pretty cool. But for the most part, we do side-by-sides. He prefers to build race cars. He also does some prep and repair. We just got finished repairing a Razor that crashed in Baja. And we've been working on trying to get one of the Can-Ams on the Can-Am team a better racer. It's been having a lot of problems, so he took it over and trying to fix all that. So he really can work on anything. He loves to build race cars of any class. And for me, my part really, I'm the parts runner. I'm the computer person. I make the phone calls. I collect the money. I help in the shop when I can, but I can't weld or anything like that. I can do bolts, nuts and bolts, and things like that. But that's pretty much it.
Awesome. And so with that being said, and you've been in the shop for since the beginning of the UTV world, what do you guys feel is the biggest change in the off-road industry that's happened recently?
Well, for one of the biggest things that happened was the crash that happened in California with the bystanders. It really changed the spectator part of racing. It changed the way, like at the Mint, now the spectators have to pay to park in a spot and watch the race. It changed. We have speed limits now where we never used to have speed limits. I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing, but it has changed that a lot. And, you know, like I said before, the side-by-side is getting so fast. Now that's changed huge since we used to race, they called us golf carts, you know, and now we're pretty much just a buggy.
Right. And a fast buggy.
A fast buggy. So that being said, also, it's changed the way we used to start in front of everybody with the bikes and quads. Well, we're too fast for that. And so now we're starting back with the other classes that are comparable to us. So it's really changed. You can't just flat out call butt if you're the fastest guy, you're going to win, because now the track's all chewed up from the fast guys in front of us. You know, it made a little bit different, better for us, makes it a little bit more competitive.
Yeah. Yeah. So speaking of the fans, you brought them up. What's probably one of your fun, crazy fan interactions that you've had?
The best one I had, I had a little girl. We were at the Off-Road Expo last year, and she came up with her family and wanted to take a picture with me and just love the car because it's pink, of course.
Yeah.
her family was super cool, and we hung out a little bit, gave her an autograph, and sent them on their way. And then we went to the Powder Puff race last year, and I had a radius rod bolt fall out, so it sends me kind of off the track. And I get out, assessing the situation, and this family comes up, and this little girl comes running up, and, Dad, it's her, that's Lacrecia. And it turns out it was that little girl. It was so awesome.
Who has inspired you the most into your successes?
I think, really, I keep mentioning her name, but Corey Weller is one of my biggest inspirations. And she's one of the first female racers I've ever met. And she was racing side-by-sides then, and she races them still today. And it's really hard to be competitive in a man's world and to be taken seriously. I remember them writing a story about her on UTV Underground, and all they kept saying was, well, she has a really fast car. Well, they all have really fast cars, but she's doing great because she's a great driver. And so I look up to her because she's changing the R1, you know, and the Pro 4, the way people look at women drivers. And I feel like I have too, just kind of trying to follow in her footsteps.
Yeah. That's awesome. Do you see yourself doing any other types of racing? Is it kind of UTV is what you guys are good at?
You know, I would love to. Before we really got into UTVs, we used to do a lot of rock crawling. I know you guys are into that. And my husband and I make a really good team at that also. And we were going to do, at the time, they used to have Formula Toys because it's economical and competitive. And we really wanted to do that. I would really like to do like an Ultra 4 type of race or even just a stock Jeep and do like a King of the Hammers race one time. I think that we would be really good at that.
I think that would be fun to have you out there. How much of the rocks have you done with your side-by-side?
With the side-by-side, a little bit here and there. You know, in Havasu, we have a lot of rocks. So we've done a little bit. I don't have a lot of experience in the side-by-side doing rocks, but I could get as much as I want if I had the time to go out and do it, for sure.
Do you guys do a lot of wheeling on the side or just racing? Or?
We do as much as we can. During the real tight race season, it's hard for us to get away, but we really try to go out. We have such a beautiful desert here, and we can take off right from our house, and we just go out and go ride. So we do as much as we can. It's really, really hot right now, so it's a little tough. We go at night here and there and take some short rides at night. But as much as we can, we love it. We love to go and ride other places and see the scenery.
So racing against all the boys, right, and playing with all the boys and doing everything that you do, what's a piece of advice that you want to give to the next generation of racers or pit crews or spectators?
I would just say, for me, like, I've always just been one of the guys. Like, I feel like I'm friends with most of the drivers. We can hang out after the race, swap stories, and I've never tried to be a princess. Like, I'm not a girly girl anyway, obviously, but you can't be a princess and be on the sidelines and let other people work on your car and then get in the car and cry if somebody bumps into you. And you really just kind of, I guess you kind of got to fit in and be one of the guys. My crew doesn't treat me any different than they would if I was one of the guys.
Right.
You know, so we're just a race team. Me being a woman driver just happens to be how it is, I guess.
And do you have a woman co-driver as well, or just a guy?
Not all the time. My current full-time co-driver is Chris Moore. He's also the marketing manager at Dragonfire Racing. He's really good. He's small. That helps. So we're both light in the car. I've had women co-drivers, and they were awesome too. But one of the things that came with getting better and better and faster is things break. And I need someone in the car that knows the car as well as I do, and they can help me fix it. And I have a hard time with some of the women drivers, just the co-drivers, they can't do that.
Yeah, that's one of the challenges. And it's something that we're also talking to Jason Voss earlier, where he has his crew chief in the car. So one of the big strategic advantages is knowing the vehicle.
Exactly. And it's just hard. A lot of the girls like to go with me, and we have fun in the car. But I haven't met anyone that has as much passion for it as I do that wants to. I want to take my car apart when it's time to tear it down so that I know how to fix it if it breaks. And I don't have a lot of people that have that passion or even that kind of time to come over and sit here and do that with me. So the boys, I guess it's just something that they do naturally.
Right. That makes a lot of sense, too. Well, With all that being said, what is next on your list of things to do?
Our next race coming up is Vegas to Reno. It's a big race. It's an endurance race. We're really excited because we're leading in the points, and really all we got, we just want to finish. All we have to do is finish and probably lock up the championship. So we're really excited for that. And then we have a bunch of shows coming up after that. So anybody that wants to come out and check out the car and meet us and hang out a little bit, we'll be at the Off-Road Expo in Phoenix. We'll be at the Sand Show in Costa Mesa. And we'll be at the Off-Road Expo in Pomona. So a lot of fun stuff coming up.
Awesome. Who has inspired you to be successful within your local group?
Mostly my husband, I guess. You know, we're very competitive. I learned how to drive because of him. We compete against you every time we go out. It's a race, I guess. We're very competitive with each other. And if you don't keep up, he doesn't wait for you. So if you don't want to get lost, you got to keep up.
Right.
So I try to live up to that even when he's not in front of me and try to race to the best of my ability. And he really inspires me, you know, just to be the best driver that I can be. He knows that what I have in me. He knows what I do when we go out play. Sometimes it's a little more cautious on the racetrack. You got to save your car. But, you know, so he really tries to bring that out in me. And I like that. You know, he really is my inspiration here at home.
Well, that's awesome. Okay, are you ready for the biggest question of the day?
Sure.
Zip ties or duct tape?
Zip ties. I think I have both, but zip ties probably. In 2009, we raced Vegas to Reno with a friend of ours. We took his Razor, and one of the cars cut out in front of me just a little bit too short and put my front tire and broke the tie rod, sent me out in the desert. We didn't have parts with us, so we zip tied that suspension all up and rented into the next pit. And so I keep a lucky zip tie in my bag next to me in my car.
That's perfect. I love it. All right. Well, you can find Lacrecia on Facebook at Rockstar Racing, on Instagram at Rockstar Customz, and on Twitter at RacerGirl2909. Final word, Lacrecia?
I just want to thank you very much for having me on the air. It's been really fun. I've known you since, you said, like from 2008. It's really awesome where you've gone and where we've gone, and I think it's a great relationship, and I really appreciate you having on board.
I agree. It's very much an honor to have you on the show. As you know, you're at the front end. You were on the top of my list, so really excited for you and all your successes with Dragonfire and Polaris, and congratulations, and keep up the great work, girl.
All right. Thanks a lot. You too, and we'll see you in the desert.
All right. Next, we'll talk to an event promoter that has to helicopter in some of their supplies. Brought to you by Discount Tire.
When you're driving down the road, the last thing you want to think about is tires. Trust Discount Tire to get you up to speed with the right tire for your vehicle. We carry the world's best brands of tires, all at everyday low prices. At Discount Tire, we're not just about tires, we're about people. We'll get you the right tire for your vehicle to help keep you safe on the road. Stop by any Discount Tire store for a free air pressure and tire safety check. Your low price journey starts here. Discount Tire.
Let's welcome Bob Sweeney, the president of Jeepers Jamboree, to the show. This is the 63rd year of Jeepers Jamboree, which is either a 3-day or 4-day trip, July 23rd through 26th, and the 37th year of Jeep Jamboree, a 3-day trip, July 31st to August 2nd. Let's start there, Bob. What's the difference between your two trips?
What's the difference between our two trips? Well, Jeepers Jamboree has been going for 62 years now. We're going on our 63rd, and it's more of an adult trip. It's let your hair down, come on in, have a good time. Mm-hmm. Dance under the stars, enjoy the bar, enjoy all the groceries we feed. We have very good food, 3 meals a day, and it's where you business people can come on in, and you're just a regular off-roader.
Nice. And then what's the Jeep Jamboree trip?
Jeep Jamboree is our family trip, and this year we've also lowered the age. We just here a month ago dropped it down to 6 years of age, so The family can come in and enjoy. We do a Camp Rubicon. We're hooked up with Rubicon Trail Foundation, state parks, and tread lightly. And we do a really good things for all the young kids, educating them, letting them know what off-roading is about, how you treat the outdoors when you're out camping, you know, pack it in, pack it out. Don't drive over the good bushes. Just getting them educated a little bit better than what the TV does, I hope.
I love that. I love that. You know, that working with the kids is one of my top priorities, too, so that's great.
It's our future, Charlene. Yeah. It's our future of off-roading. We have to.
Yeah, that's great. Yes. Jeep Jamboree. A little bit of confusion maybe on the wording. So there's Jeep Jamborees that are across the country, right? Is this the same organization?
No, it is not. That's actually Jeep Jamboree USA. Jeepers Jamboree started that back in the 70s. We ran it for approximately 18 years, and then it was too hard for all of us to go out of state and take care of our families and our regular jobs. So Mark Smith decided he would run with that. So we sold that to Mark Smith, and Mark Smith stepped out of Jeepers Jamboree, and he went with Jeep USA.
Got it.
Jamboree USA.
That makes a lot of sense. So, okay.
Yeah. It's still a very good trip throughout the state. It's very good, you know, good setup, good runs. I mean, if you can't make it out here to the Rubicon, most definitely go on one of the Jeep USA trips.
Yeah, yeah, they have a lot of fun. And you guys, I mean, you're out of the same Georgetown area. You all know each other. Everybody works together, but just a little bit different on the core group.
Yes, yes.
Excellent. So when did Jeepers Jamboree start? Tell us a little bit about the history.
1952, there was approximately 12 gentlemen sitting around the poker table, and they decided, you know, we have all these Jeeps out on our ranches. Let's go out and have some fun with our ranch tools. And they decided to go up into Rubicon Springs with them. So they started in 1952, a nice little run. There was approximately 25 to 30 people that went on the very first Jeepers Jamboree run. And then it's proceeded to get larger and larger, and the partners have changed a little bit through those times. You know, our founding fathers, unfortunately, have all passed away, and now you have today's directors, you know, myself, Rob Mainwaring, Jim Morton, Kevin Arnold, Jason Warden, he's our newest partner, Mike Gerondakis, and Jimmy Morton. So there's six of us that are the directors of Jeepers Jamboree today.
With a ton of experience, not to put ages together, but just a lot of experience, and also your youth, building in the youth to it.
Exactly. You know, the one nice thing about all my partners is we're all avid four-wheelers. We've all been on a Rubicon since we were in diapers, pretty much. So it's a very friendly, good group. We all know what's, you know, going on and what's the haps.
Great. Walk us through your event. Jeepers Jamboree, now starting on Wednesday with a downtown event, and then moving in.
Yes, it's a very 15 years ago, we used to bring all the vendors into Georgetown and set up. Well, we took it away from there, and we put it on Saturday in Rubicon Springs. Well, a lot of the vendors wanted to show a little bit more than just what was on their rigs, and they were asking us, so we've brought it back now, and it's on Main Street on the 22nd, Wednesday before our trip. And this year, right now, we're signed up. We have 110 vendors.
No way.
Set up on Main Street, yes.
That's
it is,
awesome.
It's the nice thing about it, Charlene, it's not just our participants. We advertise it in all the newspapers. We have flyers out. So it's open free to the public. So a lot of the public's coming up. And they get to see all our participants that are coming out on our Thursday run. And they get to see them all lined up. And they're going, oh, wow. That looks like fun. So then they go, hopefully, and find themselves a Jeep or a friend with a Jeep, and they'll be coming next year. So it's a good another avenue for the person that's hoping to go four-wheeling. They can come out and see what it actually takes to go four-wheeling.
So,
and all the product for sale.
So people come and check in with you and get a good goodie bag, and then you send them off on the trail.
Yes, so Wednesday at noon, we open our registration. Everybody that goes on Thursday trip at noon on Wednesday can come in and get their wristband, their goodie bag, all their stickers, you know, their passes, and they'll either camp out or stay in a hotel. And then Thursday morning at Loon Lake at 6 o'clock, we serve breakfast, and you receive a boxed lunch. And then you proceed in at your own pace onto the trail. We have 32 rock rollers and 27 mechanics out there on the trail to help you go through. And then for the Friday trip, we open at noon on Thursday, and they can come in and get their wristbands, their goodie bags, but unfortunately, they missed the vendor show.
Right.
So it's really bang for your buck, come on the four-day trip, because you get the vendor show, you get the whole, you know, and one extra day in Rubicon Springs.
Yeah, which is always a ton of fun.
So Friday night, we have all our participants in Rubicon Springs. Friday night, the band starts up. We have, this year, it's Tragically White. A really, really good dance band. I've gone and watched them at three different venues, and their dance floor is just packed. They know the right songs, the right time to keep everybody up dancing. It's a really entertaining band. So you come in, you set up camp on Friday, get your dinner, get a couple cocktails, dance under the stars, and have a good time. Then Saturday morning, wake up to a good breakfast. Saturday afternoon, we are doing a special run we just released on the internet. It's 35 vehicles with 40s or better tires with alloy axles and chromoleum axles. And we're going from Rubicon Springs to Buck Island to have a lunch and then back on down. Huh. This is the first time Jeepers Jamboree has done something like this.
Yeah, I was going to say, for the most part, when you go on a Jeepers Jamboree, you come in, you park your rig, you set up your camp, and you're on foot the whole time, hanging out by the water, enjoying all the awesome food, enjoying all the awesome hospitality. And, I mean, we've gone on some hikes and looked for different historical facts, I guess, if you want to call it.
Oh, yeah, there's plenty of those historic facts all around. We have, you know, Rubicon Springs was developed back in the early 40s. It used to be actually a hay ranch down in there years ago, and they used to cut some hay there in the meadow, and then they truck it out. They've logged it. I mean, there's all sorts of neat old buildings out there that you can hike around, a couple little mine shafts, some high lakes, really, and some mineral springs. So mm-hmm. A lot of entertaining stuff right there in the springs to see. But I'm really excited about this run to Buck. You know, because we have travelers that come so far, haul their Jeeps so far, and not everybody just wants to sit by the river and relax. They want a four-wheel.
Right.
So that's why we've decided to open this up. And it's free of charge. There's no charge for this run on Saturday. It's first come, first serve on it.
That's cool. They have to
pass our inspection to be able to go on this, because it is very difficult. Charlene, I don't know if you've ever gone backwards on the Rubicon Trail, but it is.
Yep.
Gravity helps you coming in.
Yeah.
There's no gravity going back up. It's a tough wheel. It's fun.
So, yeah, I've actually done it with a disabled sports run. It's a lot of fun.
Yes.
So, the food. Food. Jeepers Jamboree, folks, you guys.
Five-star food.
Yes. You don't even know what food is on a camping trip until you've been on this one.
You know,
amazing.
How many times have you opened your ice chest up and you saw dinner floating when you've been out on your own? You won't have that with us. We have everything nice and fresh. We're cooking it for you. You come down the line, we're gonna fill your plate up. You're gonna go, oh my gosh, I have to eat all this.
Yeah, it's absolutely amazing. So with that being said, how many trailer loads does it take to get your food and everything that you need in for your guests?
57 of them.
57 trailer loads?
Yes.
And how does that happen? You strategically do that, right?
We have the American Legion helps us out, and also other volunteers. We have a very good crew that helps us out. We have 9 meat trailers that are basically They're a 4-foot by 6-foot ice chest.
Oh.
That we carry all our lettuce, all our tomatoes, our steaks, all our cold goods goes in those, and then all our dry goods are in all the other trailers.
Makes sense. And you use helicopters for some of the big stuff.
No, we do not. And this year we are not using a helicopter. And the reasoning why is, so we want our trip to be affordable. We want an affordable vacation. If we keep using the helicopter, we would have to raise our price to where people couldn't afford it. So my partners and I sat down and we discussed, and that's why we are building 6 more trailers.
Gotcha.
So we know we won't have to depend on that helicopter.
All right, so that's what's happening there.
Yes.
Makes a lot of sense. So your trailer loads are going to go up this year, or is this the anticipated amount for this year?
That's what my partners and I tonight, before you called here,
yeah,
are sitting down and penciling out. And we count up to 57 trailers.
Woo-wee, that's going to be fun.
Yeah.
Yep.
But, you know, I think what you're also asking me is how many. I have 57 trailers that are towing for us. 40 of those trailers are doing it 3 times.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, let's do our math real fast.
57 total trailers, but 40 of them do it 3 times.
Yeah. And how many people are you feeding?
We right now have, on our big trip, we have 790 people.
Yeah, that's more like it. Those are the numbers I was looking for. I knew it couldn't be so low.
No. Actually, we just made our steak order for both of our trips, and we ordered 1,200 steaks.
Woo! And they're the good ones, folks. They're not the yucky ones.
12-ounce steaks. They're a special cut from Harris Ranch for us. We're the only ones that get this cut. And let me tell you, it's the best beef you can eat.
That's awesome. Your events for this trip this year, every time you always come up with wild and crazy ideas. Sometimes you call me and say, is this wild and crazy enough? We've heard about bull riding in the past. I don't know if we'll put a picture of my mom up on the bull.
Your mom did very well on the bull.
But it happened. It happened. What do you got planned for this year?
we're bringing the bull back in because it was a hit.
All right.
So we're gonna try it another year. And everybody, it's free. Everybody needs to get on that. The guy is not going to just throw you off. I want to see every participant hop on that. This is your opportunity to have fun. You go to the county fair, you're paying for it, and that guy is going to chuck you off. Here in Rubicon Springs on Jeepers Jamboree, he's not going to just chuck you off. We want you to have fun with it.
That'll be a ton of fun. We'll try and keep her off of it this year. I think she bribed the guy last year.
I doubt it. Your daddy had a big old smile on his face when he was seeing his bride out there riding that bull.
So since I brought up my mom and dad and Jeepers Jamboree, they've been going since I was a baby. This was their escape from the kids weekend. And to the fact that they never even let us go. So my brother and I were never allowed on Jeepers Jamboree. This was their trip. And I was well into almost my 30s before I went on my first Jeepers Jamboree. And
the 58th was your first, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so. Yes, because I came back for the 60th and always making plans. Yeah. But I had a great time. It's such a fun trip. And so relaxing. Like, people don't realize you don't have to wheel the entire time. You just got to get there, have a great time, have your cocktails in your cooler, and enjoy the scenery, enjoy the water.
And the biggest nice part about it is cell phones do not work.
And cell phones definitely do not work.
Yeah.
So one question, kind of a big picture. How has your event supported or helped extend this off-road industry that we know today since its conception?
You bring that up. I really feel Jeepers Jamboree, there's no other Jeep trip that has been going as long as we have. I feel, you know, we made the off-road industry what it is today. For the years that we've been doing it and bringing it to the public, it's brought the manufacturers to stay with the times for the vehicles, you know, and the fab shops and the winches and everything. You know, they're more of a, what's the word am I looking for? They're not just such of a tool. They are relaxing, it's so you can go out and have fun. Recreational,
yeah.
Yes, vehicles. Now, they're not a tool. You know, look at the winches. They used to be for boats, for equipment. Now they're set up with ropes on them. They're friendly. They got air compressors on them. They're designed for the recreational person now.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I definitely agree. You guys have had the event running clearly the longest and ton of Jeeps through. Something else I want to point out is you don't have to have the Jeep on 40s with all the lockers and everything else super crazy in order to go on the Jeep Jamboree, Jeepers Jamboree. You can, my parents, we all ran flatties through on the 60th. It was a ton of fun. They have the rock rollers there. They're there to help. They have all the mechanics there. They're there to help. Everybody, you know, has hands on deck to make sure that you have an awesome trip.
Absolutely. We've brought in a bone stock. We've had vehicles come in right off the lot with paper plates on them, stock, and taking them through there with our guides. Our rock rollers are there to make sure you keep a smile on your face, that you're having an enjoyable time.
I agree, and I always have an enjoyable time out there. So the big question, are you ready?
All right.
Zip ties or duct tape?
Zip ties or duct tape? I don't plan on getting in trouble.
What's the thing you've held on the most with it?
Huh?
Most important thing you've held on with a zip tie. I know you've done it.
Most important thing that I've held on with a zip tie?
Mm-hmm.
My pants. When I forgot my belt at home.
And we've all done that before. All right. Well, you can find out more about Jeepers Jamboree on their website, jeepersjamboree.com, Facebook page, Jeepers Jamboree and Jeep Jamboree, and on Twitter at Jeepers Jamboree. Now, let's carry on to our developing Oh Wow section, brought to you by BF Goodrich Tires.
Are you driver enough to handle the ultra-high performance of the new BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 all-season tire or the rugged toughness of the all-terrain TAK02? From August 31st to September 27th, get a $50 or $70 MasterCard reward card after submission when you buy a set of four new BF Goodrich passenger or light truck tires. Head to your local BF Goodrich dealer today. See redemption form for complete offer details. Offer expires 9/27/2015. Void where prohibited. Reward card issued by U.S. Bank pursuant to license from MasterCard International Incorporated.
We're going to welcome Chad from Warren back to our Oh Wow section, where we're going to dispel some myths about winching and winches. Thank you, Chad, for hanging out with us a little bit longer.
You betcha.
So let's start with the difference between winch ropes. What is the difference between wire versus synthetic? And then maybe we'll roll into the Spidura line.
You know, I get a lot of questions on the winch rope quite often. I mean, at every show, everybody's asking the questions. And I think it depends. You know, they're not one safer than the other. They're just two different creatures. So depending on how you're going to use it, I kind of lean one way or the other depending on the customer. So if you are a racer where you're out winching, you know, regularly, I lean towards synthetic rope because you're actually going to use that rope on a regular basis and you're going to get some use out of it during the lifespan of that rope. If you're the guy that puts a winch on and it's more of an insurance type policy for you, so you might drive around for 2 years and that third year you use it once and then it sits for another couple of years and then you use it again, then I lean towards wire rope. And the reason is because you're using it so seldom that that wire rope today will be wire rope 10 years from now and you don't really have to do much maintenance on it. So definitely two different guys. I like both of them. I run wire on my big truck because I don't winch very often with it. And I run synthetic on my Jeep because we winch more often.
Is there some kind of stretch component to that? That's a common myth that's out there, is the wire rope doesn't stretch and the synthetic does.
They're similar as far as the properties when you start winching down on them. Obviously, you're building up energy, but they don't stretch. They're not elastic. But one thing that you do notice with the synthetic rope is it's slippery. So when it's on the drum and you're going to do a pull, you need a full layer of rope all the way across that first drum layer at the drum level. And you can actually watch the rope work around the drum until it actually gets a bite in. And then on the wire rope, you'll have 4 or 5 wraps on the drum, and you'll just see that as soon as you put a load on it, it just clamps onto that drum and hangs on, and it doesn't slip.
Gotcha. Okay. Why do you put something over the rope when you're winching?
Rope dampers. For the situation where you do have something come apart or come loose or come off, you're not going to stop that from happening. Eventually it's going to happen, but at least the rope dampers will keep it low to the ground. And I lean towards a rope damper because the rope damper itself is a little bit heavier than a jacket. A jacket will work if that's all you have, but the damper will actually keep it down. And then in some cases with wire rope, I'll even add some weight to that, or I'll use my winch bag in addition to the rope damper with stuff in it. Just leave the winch bag on the ground and put the strap up over the rope. And if you're doing multi-line pulls, you want a damper on each of the lines.
Okay, well, that makes sense. 10,000-pound winch, does that mean I can pull 10,000 pounds?
So, yes. At the drum level, so the first layer of rope on the drum, that winch will not only will it pull 10,000 pounds, it will also apply the brake at 10,000 pounds. So if you stop winching and you actually have 10,000 pounds on it, that brake will hold that 10,000 pounds.
Gotcha. Okay. And because you're the winch professional and you're out on the trails all the time, what's your biggest pet peeve? What's the most common mistake that you see?
I see people hooking their winch up and then getting towed with it. So instead of using a recovery strap, their buddy will be pulling them up the hill with the winch line. And the internal damage that can be going on might not show up when that happens exactly, but, you know, maybe a year down the road and then you're putting a good strain on that winch. The little micro fractures that might have happened during that tow will show up when you least expect it.
Interesting. That was all excellent information. And we'll be right back.
Are you driver enough to handle the ultra-high performance of the new BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 all-season tire or the rugged toughness of the all-terrain TAK02? From August 31st to September 27th, get a $50 or $70 MasterCard reward card after submission when you buy a set of 4 new BF Goodrich passenger or light truck tires. Head to your local BF Goodrich dealer today. See redemption form for complete offer details. Offer expires 9/27/2015. Void where prohibited. Reward card issued by U.S. Bank pursuant to license from MasterCard International Incorporated.
Wow, that was another great show filled with facts and information. If you would like to learn more about our guests, we have posted a whole page on them on our website. Remember, you can watch Bauer Power Hour on YouTube, Vimeo, or listen on an assortment of podcast outlets. Like and follow us on Facebook or Instagram at Bauer Power Hour Show and Twitter at BPH Show. Well, of course, next week we have another A-plus lineup for you. Be sure to check out our Powerball page to submit your questions for next week's guests. If they answer your question on the show, you will win a very fancy Bauer Power Hour shirt with gifts. If you'd like to be a guest on our show or know someone who should, or just want to contact us, visit our website and click on Let's Chat. All those options and more are right there. Well, guys, I've got to get back to work. Have a great week in the dirt.
Want to learn more about the guests on today's show? Visit www.powerpowerhour.com. BauerPowerHour.com for more information, photos, and videos. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter by searching for Bauer Power Hour Show for daily breaking news updates.